my family and I have been involved with Trinity Ministry for about 8 years now. And if you're like my wife Lori and I, you really appreciate the children's program and the youth ministry and the encouraging worship on Sunday morning, and maybe even the opportunity to serve around the world in one of our missions trips. Chances are, though, what you know about Trinity is this. If you think about all that God has faithfully done in and through the ministry of Trinity, it's really quite amazing to consider that the Church of Trinity actually began 25 years ago right here in Highland, California, in this very house, at the time owned by Bill and Patty Roth.
Patty and I moved to Highland in 1979, about June, after graduating from Dallas Seminary along with several other couples that were coming to teach at the International School of Theology. And there were four couples, Ron and Mary Jensen, Hope and J.P. Moreland, Dub and Kathy Rogers, and Patty and myself.
And we were looking for a church that would meet the needs of our families. And most of us were very family-oriented, you know, full-time moms. Even though we were in the ministry, we considered that our first priority. So we wanted a church that really ministered to the kids.
And then eventually one day Jay told me, he said, hey, Ron Jensen is thinking that we might want to start a church as an outreach of the School of Theology. And the first thought came to mind, well, we could use our home. And that's how it all began.
The vision for starting the church originally, which was originally called Highland Evangelical Free Church, was we wanted to change our world. We actually did. Most of us who were involved in the very beginning, the handful of couples, were connected by and large with Campus Crusade. I was a direct report to Bill Bright, and most of us got involved with Crusade because of his call to come help change the world. So we said, can we develop a church that reflects Jesus Christ and the way the body of Christ ought to function, that can actually have a deep, penetrative impact, salt and light, on first Highlands and Redlands and San Bernardino, and then ultimately be a model for churches around the country and around the world. So we started with a real big vision on the very front end.
One of our key priorities was just that, having a ministry for the kids, having a learning center concept that several of us were familiar with. So we began to pray and have some Bible studies and began to talk about what we could do about that, about forming a church ourselves.
And then in November of 1979, about one or two Sundays before Thanksgiving, we had the first meeting of the church in our home.
I remember when we first came in there, not counting the adults who were out with the children, there were about 18 to 20. And it was pretty packed at 18 to 20.
I don't recall ever spending much time counting everyone with all the kids. I'm sure some of the guys did. My priority was more getting the place clean.
Well, my kids had Sunday school in the garage, and I was very nervous that my kids were the oldest children in the church, and my oldest was in sixth grade. I also had a third grader and a second grader, and I was wondering if there would be enough children for them to be part of any kind of a group later on.
We had all sorts of complex circumstances. We had no full-time pastor, which probably is a good thing. Sometimes, at least in the beginning stages, because it forced others to lead, so we passed leadership around.
The teaching of these men of God was just phenomenal. I mean, Ron is a high-paid teacher and lecturer now, goes all over the world. And then J.P. Moreland is such an intellect that he was challenging you, and Deb Rogers and the others. They're fabulous preaching.
The church grew, and it became obvious that we were going to outgrow our home, as would be expected, and began to contact other people. And I was able to talk to the people at Aquinas High School in the northern part of the Del Rosa section of San Bernardino. And they were willing to give us their library.
Until that, we outgrew.
From there to the Adventist Academy, Fairview, I think it was, on Date Street.
And outgrew that.
And then when we left there, we went to the San Andreas Junior High.
Outgrew that.
We saw God faithfully bring in people really rather rapidly, so we grew rather quickly.
I think the church grew because a lot of people needed enthusiasm and excitement in terms of following Jesus. They wanted to grow in their spiritual walk, and this is a church that took seriously their faith and helped people grow.
When we were growing, it became clear to all those involved that we needed to get a real pastor if we were going to go past. Just Ron, Dr. Jensen, and the rest would come in, but there was no continuity. They would come in for a week or two, and then they'd be traveling, and then somebody else would come in.
And so as we talked with a number of people, it became evident that Chuck Miller was the person who had this experience and very much had children's ministry and youth ministry on his heart. Chuck very much desired to bring Steve Krantz on board with him, and the rest is history.
From the very beginning, even in the times where the church was very small, we had a sense that this would become a great church. It never occurred to us that this church might not work. And Chuck Miller had that special ability to inspire that sense of vision in us. And it was a lot of hard work. But even when we occasionally would have some setbacks, as all church plants do, there was always a sense that we shared that someday this would be a great church that would have an impact not only on the greater Highland area, as we called it at that time, but also around the world.
At every point, it seemed that we transitioned to a new building. That signified kind of a new season. It was such a struggle to get the property, and we would pray and pray and pray about where should we have the next facility. We're outgrowing this one, and the realization we've got to make this big shift, and also the realization that every time you move, you have the possibility of losing people because you've lost the location. So it was about keeping the momentum up and making that transition smooth and asking God to really help us through.
I remember Chuck Miller getting together the ministry team just before a worship service and putting us into a huddle like we were a football team, fourth quarter on the 2-yard line with 1 second left. And he would get us in a huddle and he would clench his fist and he would say, "Every cell in my body breathes with responsibility, and we will not fail." And we had that sense that when things just weren't working or kind of coming apart, that we would rededicate ourselves to God's vision for that church, and we would not fail, that this would be a great church, and God would be glorified through it.
We didn't want it to be traditional in the wrong sense. We wanted to hold on to the good traditions, but we wanted to be very much alive, very transparent, very authentically loving, not people pretending to be perfect, but people who are really committed, as Corinthians says, to progress by growing from glory to glory into the likeness of Christ.
Ted and Jan Ewing came to work with the youth, and of course by then I wasn't worried about anybody working with the youth. They took our kids under their wings and mentored them, role modeled for them, and were amazing.
And as a result, they wanted their friends to come involved, and the church grew first by the youth. The youth kept on coming, the teenagers kept on coming, and then the parents started following.
My first interaction with Trinity was as a junior in high school, and I knew there was something different in the youth group, the kids there, beyond just looking for the cute guys. I knew that there was something more personal, and in my senior year I went to a high school retreat, and that is where I realized what they were truly telling me was the gospel, that was personal relationship with Christ. And I mean, I was just eating up the word in discipleship groups and in fellowship groups, and then here I am today as an assistant children's pastor.
One of the distinctives that were very important to us early in the life of the church was what we used to call intimate burden-bearing fellowship. And that was expressed in our koinonia groups. Small group fellowship was always foundational to what the church life was all about. We worked hard at being a church of close friends and not just a church that was a filling station, but a church where people would come and build close, intimate, burden-bearing fellowship.
By 1983, the small fellowship in Highland had actually moved 4 times, growing to almost 200 people. As a result, they moved here to the Redlands Adventist Academy, but were only able to meet here for about 1.5 years before they moved across the street. to Arrowhead Christian Academy. The move to Redlands also brought about another important change.
Well, during that time, Trinity was definitely at a transition, and I do believe that Larry Pullen was the man for the job. It was a time where they were changing. We were at a new building at a new point in Trinity's life and beginning to just really grow.
Well, I think when I came on board as the senior pastor, we were running about maybe 250 or 300, and it was a wonderfully encouraging thing as the program coalesced again and the leadership team began to strengthen, and we had some wonderfully gifted people on the staff. We had, I guess, a staff of maybe four or five at that time. And in the 6 years, it went from like maybe 250, close to 300, to running on the average about 800 a Sunday, and then we would, blow the top off on Easter and Christmas with maybe 1,000 to 1,200. Given the fact that we didn't have our own facility and we're meeting in schools, two different schools during that period of time, and also it was really evidence that God was in the program and He was in our leadership team and He was moving in the lives of the people.
I remember when Rick Langer and Sherry came, and he came here also as Steve Krantz was leaving, and he came in to take on the associate pastor role. And I remember when Steve Springstead came right out of the School of Theology, and Jeannie has done just a phenomenal job. We always had very, very competent, qualified, godly people.
One of the biggest challenges that the church faced, and I think every church faces, is the question of to build or not to build, when to build, where to build. In fact, we had a significant contingent in the church that never wanted to own our own building. And I remember even when this beautiful property, which we now occupy, was available, there was not unanimity on this site. I remember, it was an awful $25,000 an acre. And I'm thinking, wow, $25,000 an acre, that's a steal. It was a very, very tough time. The good thing is it never divided the elders and it never divided the church. It was an obvious act of God, and the thing that sealed it was the day that the realtor and I sat across the freeway on the top of the hill up there by the sunset and looked at that beautiful piece of property. I shared Christ with the realtor, and right there he prayed with me to invite Christ into his life. And it was a testimony that God was in this, even at times when we didn't know what He was doing.
When Pastor Gary Unrig and Elizabeth came, and he had a tough role, because when he came, we were going to be in a building program. And it's always said, the pastor that builds is not the pastor that enjoys. Because it's really difficult to build. It puts a lot of pressure on a lot of the people. But with a strong, strong support that we had from our church and outside people helping in, we were able to see our current church become a reality.
I think it's really interesting to see how God has just opened door after door for Trinity Church, from one location to the next, from one pastor to the next. Even in the last 10 years with the different pastors that are involved in the different ministries, how God has just brought those people along.
Sometimes there are people who probably take Trinity for granted, and everybody has to start somewhere and they can enjoy it for what it is, but I think it helps to know about the history and how it started just in a basic home, in a very simple way with some very simple people. And I think it does something to understand that and realize how it has grown, because it's an encouragement for what God can do in a life. It's almost metaphorical.
Bankruptcy wasn't an option. It was God's called us. We're going to see what God does. And of course, the rest of the story. And thank God for those faithful people over the years who've kept driving and listening to the Lord and moving forward in the building out of the body.